Hi learners, welcome to Elements of Network Simulation. In this session we are going to see a topic on wireless ad hoc networks, so also called as mobile ad hoc networks, called as MANETs. This is what we are going to discuss in this topic. So the overview of this session is what is wireless ad hoc networks, what are the different routing protocols, how they are categorized, reactive routing and proactive routing protocols, performance comparison of these protocols, and simple simulation results for AODV and DSDV. This is what we are going to see in this session. So parallelly, after this session over, so we will be doing some experimentation using NS3 for comparing these protocols. So what is wireless ad hoc network? So it is a collection of wireless mobile nodes dynamically forming a temporary network without the use of any existing network infrastructure or centralized administration. So that means that, so this kind of network is infrastructureless. So that means they do not have any infrastructure directly. Let's say one good example is, so you have a laptop with you. Similarly, there are some laptops like this. They are having a Wi-Fi driver in it. So using that three laptops, they can able to form a network without any access point or any routers. So that is what we call ad hoc networks. So how do we do? That is what the challenge behind the routing protocols. So this is what called as wireless ad hoc networks. An ubiquitous type of computing often referred to as pervasive or invisible computing. So that's what this. And present, appearing or found everywhere. And pervasive means spread through or into every part of. So this network lies everywhere. So one good example here is, you are using hotspot nowadays. So hotspot means you can use your Wi-Fi device to share the hotspot there. So using this hotspot, that also considered under wireless ad hoc networks. So properties of ad hoc networks. So require devices to cooperate autonomously without any user intervention. So that means that these networks operate autonomously. All the nodes in the devices network will be operating on their own without any user intervention. Rapid self-organizing wireless network. So rapid self-organizing means, if there is any failure in the particular node, automatically they form alternative path, automatically they form another network. That's what self-organizing. Independent of infrastructure, as we discussed, there is no need of access point. But there are two modes, with access point, without access point. There are two modes. Without access point means all the nodes form a network themselves. Okay, so heterogeneous and adaptive. So they are heterogeneous means each and every node could be of different manufacturer, different energy levels, different medium access control, but still they can talk to each other. And adaptive means they can adapt to the networking behavior. So ad hoc networking, so a mode of loosely connected networking characterized by the following qualities: lack of fixed infrastructure. So we don't need any fixed infrastructure. Peer-to-peer, all nodes access routers. So here, this is what one of the challenging thing. So all the nodes can act as a router. So multi-hub routing. So multi-hub routing means, let's say for example, if this is the source node and there are nodes here, and there are nodes, and here there are nodes, here there are nodes, and this is the destination node. So this destination and this is the source. Now when the packet is being sent here, so the packet from here to here, the packet has to be sent. But this packet, this node, they are not reachable from this source to destination. So what it will do is, it will send a packet from directly here. Here the packet will be sent. This node forward the packet. So forwarding node. And this node can forward here and then finally forward here. So this is what one hop. In another way, this also will be one path. In another way, this also will be one path. So even if this node fails, then automatically this path will be taken care. So this is what we called as multi-hop. Multi-hop means hop number 1, hop number 2, hop number 3, hop number 4. So here we have totally 4 hops. So this is what we called multi-hop routing. So there are various protocols operating under multi-hop routing. Then frequent connection and topology changes. So usually the topology changes frequently because of the node mobility. So here this node can move, or even the destination itself can move, or the source can move. So any node in the network can move. So obviously there will be frequent disconnection. So automatically the topology also will be changing. So what are the challenges in ad hoc networks? Is security is the main challenge. So what kind of security, whether we consider information security as network security, we have to categorize both, and we have to, there's a very great challenge here. Scalability. So if the number of nodes are increasing in the network, how do we handle the scalability issues? Then load balancing, etiquette between the host. So that means that between the host to host connection, how they can exchange packets between them. So there are some called as trust based nodes. So that means that each node will have a trust value based on the trust. Good trust means the packet will be forwarded between the nodes. Bad trust means the node will not forward to a particular node. And quality of service is one of the greatest challenge here. So usually wireless networks have less quality of service when compared to wired network, but how do we ensure quality of service? So that is again one of the challenge. CPU memory overhead. So usually CPU and memory will be occupied very huge. Effect on devices battery life. So this is one of the greatest thing is the battery life. So how long the battery can withstand for this particular wireless ad hoc networks. These are the different challenges. Then protocol design. So how do we design a protocol? So it is must run in distributed environment. So the first issue is the entire network is distributed. Must to provide loop free routes. That means that let's say for example, between source to destination, the packet should not be looped. So it should be it should not be in the loop. That is loop free routes. So the routes should be computed in such a way that there should not be any loop. Else what happened, the packet will be rotating in the loop. Must be able to find multiple routes. So this is one of the again next issue in designing protocol. So as I showed you in the previous diagram, we have computed three routes. So similarly we have to have multiple routes. Must establish routes quickly. So here this is again one of the issue is the protocol should find the effective routes immediately in a faster way. Must minimize overhead in its communication reaction to topology change. So this overhead is always a challenge in wireless networks. So overhead means because of some frequent disconnection, in what way the network come up again. So in that case, what is the overhead occurs over there? So this is also one of the issues in designing the protocol. So what are the different protocols available here? So as far as this subject, we will consider only main four protocols. The protocols are based on AODV, DSR, DSDV, and finally OLSR. These are the four protocols we are going to compare. So proactive and reactive to topology changes. So this is what the first categorization. Proactive protocol and reactive routing protocol. So this is where most of the protocols, all these four protocols rise in any of these, proactive and reactive. And we have flat versus hierarchical architecture and table based, demand driven, associativity driven. So these are the different categories of protocol implementation. So table based means the routing protocol will be based on the table. So source node, destination node, how the packet will be sent. Based on the table only, the data will be, the packet will be routed. So for example, DSDV, it's based on table driven. And demand driven means whenever there is a demand, the packet will be transmitted. So AODV is based on demand driven. And in fact, the DSR also based on demand driven. So this way, we can have the implementation in various. So in the classification of routing protocols, so we have proactive routing protocol and reactive routing protocol. In the proactive routing protocol, we have OLSR and DSDV. In reactive, we have DSR and AODV. So what is proactive, what is reactive, we will be seeing it. So these are the four protocols we are going to evaluate on this entire next 2 weeks. We will be doing only on these four protocols. Okay, so now proactive routing means usually table driven. So table driven means based on the routing table. So we usually have a routing table for these protocols. So usually based on the routing table, the packet will be routed. So here in this fourth point is the route is already known before a packet is forwarded. That means that already the routing table is computed with the help of various parameters. So based on the source, destination and other thing information, the routing table is completely filled, and based on the routing table, the data or packet will be forwarded. Whenever any node is dead in between, or whenever any node is out of battery or out of this energy, then the routing table will be computed again. So for that we have a higher overhead. So because of the routing, not only the routing table updation and other stuff, so we have the overhead happens here. have lower latency due to maintenance of routes at all times. So maintenance of the route will be at all the time, so we have lower latency here. So this is the problem of this proactive routing. Reactive routing is usually on demand. So on demand means whenever there is a demand, the route will be selected, the path will be selected. Higher latency, since the routes have been to be computed on demand, that means that latency is higher, seeing that usually the route will be computed on demand. So that means that whenever there is a need, the path will be computed, so it slightly takes more time to get triggered first. Lower overhead, since routes are maintained on demand, so the overhead is high there, but here it is low. Determine a route only when there is a data to send. So this is the advantage of reactive routing. So the path will be sent only when there is a data to be sent. So two protocols we'll be comparing now, because after understand these two protocols, we can able to get knowledge on the remaining two protocols. So AODV under reactive routing and DSDV under proactive routing. So DSDV means destination sequenced distance vector algorithm. AODV means ad hoc on demand distance vector algorithm. Okay, so we have another two protocols called as DSR. So DSR is called as dynamic source routing. So this is one of the protocol. It's similar like AODV, but slightly sometime powerful than AODV. And OLSR, object link state routing. Link state routing. So this is the next protocol. So all these four protocols only we are going to evaluate their performances. So AODV. So AODV is purely on demand. As the name says, it is on demand, so it is reactive. So no routes determined until needed. Each node contains routing table of next hop information for how to get to every other node. So that means that a node will have a path information of other node. This node have the information of other node. This node have the information like that. The path will be formed. So accordingly, the packet will be sent between nodes like this. So each and every node will be having the information about the next nodes. So here, this is how the way happens here. So here you can consider this a source. And this is a destination. Destination is the source. So we have a path N1, N3, N5, then N7, N thing. And here via N1, N4 and like this. And N2, N5 and N8 like this. So we have this three path available. So when the AODV packet is being sent first time when they form the network, so the source initiated the packet and it will send to all the neighbors. The neighbors are N3, N4 and N2. So once the packet have been sent to the neighbors, usually the packet name called as RTS. Usually it is called as RTS. That means a request to send. There's the name of the packet, request to send. Usually RTS is broadcast. So this packet is broadcast. So broadcast means it will send to all the neighbor nodes. Now once N2 receives, N2 sends again some more RTS to its own neighbors. So likewise, every RTS packet will be across the entire network. After that, the destination will respond via the shortest path possible. So in that case, we called as RREP. So that is here route request. Is what given here? Route request. So RREQ is route request. Here route response. So route response is the next level. First level is RTS, it is request to send. First, usually when they form a network, usually RTS messages will be flooded across the entire network and clear to send will be there. Means only whichever node wanted to send the packet, so they will be sending the CTS message. So CTS message will be unicast. So CTS is unicast and RTS is multicast. Broadcast. So this is what happened in RTC. After this is established, then we'll send a route request response, that is RREQ. So it's RREQ also again the same way, it is on the broadcast channel. So every node, every network, every node in the network will be sending packets to everywhere till it reaches the destination. But see, the destination is sending only via one path, maybe the shortest path, or maybe the path with the limited energy, maybe the path with very low latency, maybe the path with any other parameter, good quality of service. So based on all this stuff, the route response will be sent back to the source. Then the source will fix this is the path for the next packet. Likewise, the network forms in AODV. See, the source code initiates the discovery process by sending a route request. to its neighbors, which in turn to their neighbors, and so on till it reaches a destination. Route request is usually broadcast, and it has the broadcast ID and the IP address. It contains two values, one is IP address, another is the broadcast ID. Once the neighbors are ready, they can send back the RREP to the source node, which initiated the RREQ. Usually RREP is unicast. It will send it to via a path to the source node, which initiated the RREQ. So whichever path it is used, the same path the RREP will be responded. So that is what in AODV handles. Next thing is DSDV, so which is on the proactive routing protocol. It is called as destination sequence distance vector. So it is based on distance vector algorithm. So it is mainly on destination. Avoidance of routing loops is the main feature in this protocol. So routing loops will be avoided here because the entire routing table is computed, pre-computed. Each node maintains a routing table to the destination. It also contains the number of hops needed to reach the destination. So that means that there are three nodes like this. Each node have a routing table like this. So this routing table maintains the data like this. So it contains the number of hops needed to the destination. It maintains the entire value about the route. Sequence numbers are used to differentiate between the old and the new routes. So every time when a packet is sent, there will be a sequence number. The sequence number implement like this. So sequence num plus plus. Every time when the sequence number is sent, it will be added one value extra. So that means that based on the sequence number, you can identify whether the packet has been reached or not. So accordingly, the old and the new route can be computed using the sequence number. Updates in the routes are sent periodically to all nodes. So that means that suppose, for example, if this node fails, then how this node can be sent back to packet of this node. So this update will be sent periodically to all the nodes. So to update their routing tables. So this is the main challenge here in proactive routing. For updation of the routing table, it takes some time to get it updated, and again the update cycles are periodically happening. So here the broadcast of the route contains destination address, number of hops, sequence number of the information, and new sequence number. So always the highest sequence number will be used. If the updates have same sequence number, then the route will smaller hop count will be used. So that's what the number of smaller hop count will be used. So for example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's say this is a destination node, this is the source, and this is the destination, and we have one more node here. Okay, so now in this case, this is one path, it goes via this, and there is another path here. So this is the 1, 2 hops, but where here it is 1, 2, 3, 4, totally 4 hops. So whenever the sequence number comes here, so the route with the smaller hop counts will be used. That means that this route will be used because it has only 2 hops. So 2 hops means we are disturbing only 2 intermediate nodes, or here in this case only 1 intermediate nodes. Here when we want to go via this path, maybe this path when we want to go, so how many nodes we are disturbing? Node number 1, 2, 3. So we are disturbing 3 nodes apart from the source and the destination. So this is what happening in DSDV protocol. So then performance comparison. So anyway, we'll be dealing the performance comparison using NS3 in detail. I'll just rush through some of the performance characteristics. The following characteristics shows the comparison between AODV and DSDV protocol for various number of nodes, start from 10 nodes to 100 nodes. So which level 10 to 100 nodes it is compared. So what are the different metrics we have already discussed is PDR, packet delivery ratio, throughput. Then we have a end-to-end delay, E2E delay, then routing overhead. So these are the 4 parameters that we are evaluating for these 2 protocols. Now first thing is packet delivery ratio. You can see that the packet delivery ratio should be high. For a good network, the PDR should always be high for a good network. Now in this case, the value here is 0.0052. This is some in x-axis number of nodes. In y-axis you can see that the red color indicates AODV and the green indicates it is DSDV. So in that case, so the AODV has a better packet delivery ratio compared to the DSDV protocol. So in this case, AODV have an upper hand. So AODV have an upper hand. Okay, so this is on packet delivery ratio. So PDR is higher in AODV compared to DSDV. So PDR is the ratio between packet received versus packet sent. Since the PDR is high for AODV, it indicates the AODV reliability of receiving packets is high. PDR determines one of the important metric in performance analysis of the wireless protocols. So this is for the PDR. Next thing is average throughput. So throughput here, so based on the number of nodes and number of packets here. So average throughput in bits per second here. Now again you can see this is for AODV in red color, and this is DSDV in green. So again you can see throughput also is very less in DSDV, whereas it's good in compared to AODV. But some places the throughput is very less here. You can see for this number of nodes and node 90 nodes. So 90 nodes, 60 nodes and 40 nodes, there was some issue. Because of that, the throughput is too less, but still it is higher than the DSDV protocol. So this is an average throughput for the entire nodes. So throughput determines the number of packets sent per second of time. So a good network should always have higher throughput compared to the slow network. So in the above figure, we have seen that AODV outperforms DSDV. So this is the result for it. So again, we have AODV in upper hand. Okay, so two places. Third thing is end-to-end delay. So delay here is, delay should be less. So the delay factor should be less. So again, you can see in this diagram here, AODV represents the delay here. So this AODV and the green represents the DSDV. So the average delay is just, see, it's very less. So it is from 0 to 0.1 seconds. So this is the delay here. But whereas here, up to 0.07 seconds, the DSDV, again, AODV outperforms DSDV in the case of delay, end-to-end delay. So already we have discussed about this. In this also, AODV protocol maintains delay variation slightly when the number of nodes are small, medium or high. So even the according to the number of nodes size, so even see that, sorry. So in this case, the number of nodes is 10, even it is 100. So the slight variation in AODV, whereas here there is a huge variation in DSDV protocol. So routing overhead, so this is one parameter here. So the routing overhead here is AODV, we have a overhead here is up to 1. The routing overhead almost indicates the same as the packet delivery ratio. So routing overhead also similar like PDR, the overhead in sending and receiving packets is called routing overhead. So the overhead in sending and receiving packets, so that's why this value is almost point number 1, but here it is 0.9. To this, not much difference, but still it is AODV here outperforms DSDV. So this is what happening in routing overhead. So there are two different protocols we compared, namely reactive and routing proactive. Both routing methods have their pros and cons. This presentation also includes a performance comparison of two famous protocols, AODV and DSDV, under reactive and routing. As per the results, so for most of the application, AODV is preferred over DSDV, as AODV is having higher throughput, less delay and good packet delivery ratio. Of course, the routing overhead also good. But DSDV also performs well in case when the nodes are good with the energy and non-broken rules. So that means non-broken routes means the loop-free routes. So the routes are loop-free in DSDV. So for those reasons, we can use DSDV protocol, because the routing table is fixed. So we can use this protocol for these applications. So these are the references. I have just taken this graphs and some content here. So we will be seeing tomorrow. I will publish one more video based on the comparison of various support protocols with all our metrics. So thanks for listening. Thank you very much.